Thank you for inviting me here to this conference, and today I'm going to try to explain and describe some hill forts in Scandinavia, first in general terms and then particularly on Öland, where I've been excavating for many, many years. And in this paper I try to show that the forts in Scandinavia could not have been constructed on the basis of military strategic consideration only, or maybe only on a few occasions, actually. Instead, it's possible to see their location in the landscape, their architecture, and the artifacts found in the forts, and the place names around the forts in the landscape that point to that could be in or constituted places where various ritual activities took place, like assembly places or even religious festivals, and maybe also some kinds of inaugurations of for chieftains and even probably kings also. First, I'm going to say something about the Scandinavian hill forts in Sweden. There are about 1,000 of hill forts, and in Norway there are 325 hill forts, and in Denmark there are only 5 or 6 hill forts. And most hill forts in Scandinavia, particularly in Sweden and Norway, they are situated on hill, and that therefore they are called hill forts. And in Denmark, the 4 or 5 or maybe 6 that's been there are known today are either placed in marshland or are more similar like the South British Oppida. And there are 3 of them in Lolland and Falster, very huge. And the chronology of hill forts in Scandinavia, earlier in the beginning of the 19th, all archaeologists and all historians were convinced that all hill forts was from the Iron Age, and particularly the Viking Age. And then in the mid-1900s, or 1950s, several excavation took place on Öland, Gotland, and in the Mälar Valley, and almost all datings from those excavation was from the migration period. And later on in the 90s and the latest year, there have been a lot of new datings of hill forts, particularly in Sweden, and today we can see 2 major moment in history where the hill fort was constructed. The first one starts in Bronze Age and continue up to pre-Roman Iron Age, and the second major building period of forts is from the end of Roman Iron Age, the migration period, into the what we call Vandal period or the Merovingian period, and there are only very few datings from Viking Age actually. And the Viking Age is not known to be especially a calm or peaceful period. And that's an important issue for the use of the forts. And the largest complete hill fort in Scandinavia is Torsborgen on Gotland. It's 15 hectare, it's big as Eildon Hill or Treplain Loa, for example, with very massive still standing walls up to 7 meters high today. And in case you don't are familiar with the Scandinavian geography, I'm going to point to Öland. It's now Long Island, and then it's Gotland, And I'm going to continue to speak about the Icelandic forts. The fort on the island have a highly distinctive character compared to other hill forts in Scandinavia, with the exceptions of the so-called toon sites in Norway. The lack of hills on Öland promoted other types of construction of the forts. They are often circular or semi-circular in shape, and originally most of them were packed with houses inside the walls. Otherwise, the hill forts on the Swedish mainland, they are almost every hill fort on the mainland are empty, and the walls are actually just defending or encircle or hedge empty spaces or a large amount of huge block inside them. The ring fort is a usual term to describe them in the English language, but they should not be equated or confused with the Irish ring forts, which are instead enclosed farm. And the forts on Öland are not farms at all. This is Ismantorps Borg on the center of Öland. It's the best preserve of all the forts. And there are 15 forts belonging to migration period, early Roman period, migration period, up to around 700 AD. And this is the only fort on the island that's been preserved and not been used as a field or damaged by field activities by the farmers. Other forts mostly look like this. This is example from Sandbyborg, Sandby fort at the coastline, and the only of the forts on the island that's not semi-circular or circular is Borbyborg, that's been built beside a cliff. Here is all the fort placed on the map on the island together with the fields and the infield from the 17th century. And the cemetery fields and the infields is exactly the same farmland that was used during Roman Iron Age and migration period up to Viking Age. And after Viking Age, or during Viking Age, some new villages was built on the island. And as you can see, all of the forts are placed outside the farmland. They are not included in the farmland. And often they are placed between several villages in a settlement district, or larger forts are placed between several farm districts. And when it comes to the forts during this time period, they can be divided into two categories. One is the small forts, and then there are bigger forts. And the small forts are always situated in the middle of a settlement district, like this one in Triberga, and are surrounded by 8 to 11 villages. And within this historical field system, you can see traces of Iron Age migration period field systems and house foundations. And the black dots here is the belonging to the Iron Age mainly. This one is a much larger hill fort and are also situated on a much larger common or outland between much more villages. So this hill fort are situated in the middle of between 25 villages. And then during when Jan was christened, the first church was built just beside the hill fort in the same common or outland. And the largest fort on Öland is Gråborg or Torsborg, Thor's fort. It's situated almost in the middle of Öland and are surrounded by about 40 villages. And as you hopefully could see, there is a clear proportional relation between the sizes of the forts and number of the villages that surrounded them, as well as the size of the commons or outlands that they have been built upon. The fort are isolated from other contemporary ancient monuments as graves, fences, ancient fields, and so on. Consequently, the fort cannot be permanently inhabited, and therefore they could not also being acted as settlement for elite, kings or other chieftains. And just to give you some idea how the where people live, this is how the villages looked like when they was building the hill forts, the forts in Roman Iron Age migration period. They are often sparsely distributed, all the farms in the village, and they are always surrounded by three or four grey fields. And the hierarchy in the society is very easy to see today. There are almost 2,000 of these houses still visible in the landscape on Öland today. And you can divide the houses into four different sizes of farms. And we don't know what the people living on the largest farm is calling themselves, chieftains or kings, because we don't have any contemporary sources from this time period. But it's important to note that all those 25 still exist in large farms on Öland, and the same amount on Gotland are all much bigger, larger than any Anglo-Saxon farm connected to kingship or even the Irish ring forts connected to kingship. And 1928, I think it was, Sune Lindqvist, the professor in archaeology in Uppsala, wrote an article about Gamla Uppsala, Ismantorp, and Arkona on Rügen, where he suggested that the fort of Ismantorp on Öland was the same thing like the Swedish so-called kyrk. Church cities. And the church cities of northern part of Sweden, they are situated on the coastline where the river meets the sea. And all the parishes in the upper part of Sweden are huge, like three or four counties in Scotland or England. And the people living in these sparsely populated regions, they only met once or maybe twice a year in the church. And all people that owned a farm had the right to set up a miniature of their farm beside the church. And actually, all these houses found in the Ölandic forts are actually miniature of the houses found in the villages, in the farming regions. And here you can see the size of the Eastman Fort and the Epic Fort. The only totally excavated fort in Sweden, actually. And this is the largest farm on the island, and it's fields and meadows. Sune Lindqvist also related Ismantorp Fort and other Ölandic forts with Arkona, with a description made by Saxo Grammaticus in the 13th century, when Bishop Absalon conquered Arkona in 1168, I think. They conquered this fort or city, but they called it, they described it as a place surrounded by a huge wall and packed with houses inside, and in the middle of the fort or city was the temple of the god Svantevit, which they destroyed the same occasion. So illustrate Absalon and his Danish men. Some of the men that was with Absalon that year came from Öland also, but that's another history or story. This is a reconstruction of Arkona, simple one, but I like it because it was quite similar to Burghead in Moray, the Moray coast. Okay, now I try to see more in detail some peculiarities about the setting and placing of some of the forts on Öland. That might shed some light on how they were used and why they are placed, where they are placed in the landscape. This is Gråborg, the largest one. Had been destroyed by cultivation, but must have, before it was destroyed, it must have contained at least 100 or 110 houses within the walls. Okay. Sorry. Anyway, this is a little map over the fort, and you can see it placed actually not on the hill or well, there are two hills here, but it's placed actually in between two hills in the wetland. So the important thing seemed to be that the forts are placed at wetlands or springs. And the connection with water seems to be very, very important. This is Sandeborg. It's placed actually at the coast, 1 meter above the sea level. The sea level in migration period was 1 meter higher. So you can see from this picture also that it has been flushed by the sea for many, many generations and years. Ektorpsborg is placed on a tectonic feature. It's a crack. Part of this region on Öland in the limestone, where the water is pouring up in a spring. And as you can see, when they excavated the fort in the 60s, each bottom, it was covered, it was flooded, actually. And it's impossible to live in this or be in this place during the autumn and the winter. This is the three main phases of Ektorp. The first phase, 300 to 400 and 400 to 700. the fort I'm trying to talk about. And Eketorp 1 was placed beside this depression in the limestone where the water is pouring out. And later on, Eketorp 2 was built, to cover part of this spring. And afterwards, they have excavated Eketorp, they also excavated the wetlands outside and found lots of bone from ritual depositions and ritual feasting. So probably they saw this spring as a representation of Urd's wells, the well of knowledge that's described in the old Norse mythology. And most of the artifacts that have been found in the fort has nothing to do at all with military or other kind of martial context. This is Guldgubbar, is 15, was found inside the fort. The two guys to left has been interpreted as Odin when he's hanging in the world tree of Yggdrasil over the well of Urd and gaining the knowledge from it. The weapons are extremely rare in forts in general, as well as in the British Isles. And this is Sandbyborg, trying to take some. Anyway, me and a colleague made some metal detecting in this fort and found several of these gilded silver brooches from migration period. We found six in one weekend, actually, inside the fort. Before, only three were known on the Öland. And those three are all found, actually, in forts. So you can actually see this kind of object as props, theatrical props that belongs to the fort and probably was only used in the fort, together with the silver brooches, lots of exclusive beads, coral shell, maybe marble, long distance connections. And afterwards, the Kalmar County Museum made an excavation the year after we found them, and all was placed to the right inside the door on five places in the fort, very neatly. And after a few weeks of excavation, they found remnants of executed people in the houses. And this seems to be a massacre of the people living in this area, probably during a religious festival or an assembly occasion. Ismantorps Borg is situated almost at the center, the geographical center of Öland. And Anders Andrén, this is from Anders Andrén's latest book on Old Norse mythology. And he has interpreted the whole fort as a representation of the world tree Yggdrasil, with the nine gates associating with the Yggdrasil's three roads connecting the three worlds in the north mythology. And just outside this fort, 500 meters, there is a large block in the actual center of Öland that is called Inge's Stone or the Judgment Stone. And during the 17th century, an antiquarian from Uppsala was making a plan and a picture of it, and he said that people from all over, the judges from all over Öland was meeting at this stone. And it might be a parallel to Öisne Stone on island, the middle spot on this island where people were met for competitions. And there are also a folk tradition of competition and horse racing around most of the forts on the island. And this is the last picture. This is Lensfjord Fort, situated on a promontory in a lake. Besides, it's in a failure stand that can be interpreted either as Yngve Frey's sten, that is the goddess of Frey, or the Inge, which means Öningarnas, the people living on Öland. And in that case, it could be the equivalent with Skogen of Destiny or Fajal on Tora, for example. And there are lots of things, plots, now, thing, place names, assembly place names around this fort in different directions. And also on the other side in this landscape, there is the village of Eriksar, which means Erik's Kern, Erik's grave. And Erik is the Einrikar, the high king, the king who is king over other kings. All right. I'll stop there.